agricultural expedition here now. I guess the Kirtage will have a series of songs by a choir under the direction of Imraha Raymond from the college. Now after that we'll have a break for about 15 minutes and the shop will be opened underneath this stage here. They're called the Dungeons for those people who come to the college here. As well as that, during the break we'll have a raffle and you can see the prizes there on my left and your right. And tickets are 10 pence each. Now after the break we'll have the play, The Bachelor Boy. And I'll just give you an idea of what it's all about. Mick Shannon, a bachelor, and he has a little bit of a problem with drink, and his sister is so concerned about him that she procures a cure. Now this cure has some serious consequences for Mike, and you'll find out later on what they are. Now I was asked to let you know that you're not to smoke here tonight from August.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. And I was walking one morning in spring. I met with some travelers down an old country lane. One was an old man, the second a maid, and the third was a young boy who smiled as he said, with the wind.
I intend to stay safe. he keeps on rolling along. He don't plant potatoes, he don't plant cotton, and them that plant some is soon forgotten. But old man River, he just keeps rolling along. You and me, we sweat and strain, body all aching and racked with pain. Tote that bunch, lift that bale, you'll get a little drunk, and you land in jail. I get so weary and sick of trying. I'm tired of living and feared of dying. But old man River, he just keeps rolling along. Niggers all work by the Mississippi, niggers all work while the white folks play, pulling those boats from the dawn to sunset, getting no rest till the judgment day. Don't look up and don't look down, you don't just make the white boss frown. Bend your knee and bow your head and pull that rope until you're dead. Take me way back from the Mississippi, take me way back from the white man boss. Give me that stream called the River Jordan, that's the old stream that I long to cross. Old man River, that old man River, he must know something, but don't say nothing. He just keeps rolling, he keeps on rolling along. He don't plant potatoes, he don't plant cotton, and them that plant them is soon forgotten. But old man River, he just keeps rolling along. You and me, we sweat and strain, body all aching and racked with pain. So that bunch, lift that bale, you get a little drunk and you land in jail. I get weary and sick of trying. I'm tired of living and feared of dying. But old man River, he just keeps rolling along. I'm a-riding down the side.
Sailing on. the deep blue ocean. Nig ma grajal spiegel ovoem. For the seas are deep, love, and I can swim over. And neither rope have I been blind. I wish I met with a handy boatman who would ferry
elderly woman, are you waking me?
If you want to sleep, go on to bed. And don't be sitting there in the draught. No wonder you're complaining about your pains. Here's the book Father Kelly sent down.
The life of Abraham Lincoln. You know, Mary, that's what this country needs. A man like Abraham Lincoln.
I never mind the speech. Keep it for your cronies in the public house.
But it's a fact. This country needs the Lincoln far more than the niggers in America ever needed one. There's slavery from one end of this nation to the other. Aye, there is, and there's slavery right here in Belly Green, right under your very nose.
Oh, just because you have to do a decent day's work at the mill, you think you're a slave. You'll be telling me next that Mr. Macmillan stands over you with a whip.
He goes damn near it. He doesn't stand over me a little bit, because if he did, I'd soon tell himself and his shadow where to go. But there are a few fellas down there, young lads, and he gives them a dog's life. One of these days I take pity on the poor divs and I'll give that old nigger whipper a bit of my mind.
You, if you want to find yourself out in the street, and I don't think Love and the Dole would appeal to Lizzie Casey.
Lizzie Casey, Lizzie Casey, Lizzie Casey. How many times have I told you never mention that Brad Balloon's name in this house again? I suppose you think because you're my sister you can keep pestering me from morning to night about Lizzie Casey. Well, I'm going to put an end to this damn stuff once and for all. For the past 20 years, you've been pestering me, trying to marry me after that one. Well, you can try for another 20. But Mick Shannon will be still a bachelor. Lord, there was if I ever lost my senses and tied myself to that star. I suppose I'd have to go and write another Uncle Tom's Cabin. Never mention Lizzie Casey's sweet dam in this house again.
What's all the noise about? It's just one of his periodic and fits of temper, Maury. See if you can cool him down. I'll be back to fix up the dress for you in a minute or two. I must run over to Rooney's. You might not be ashamed of you.
Lizzie Casey.
What's that is? What's the name of the book?
'Tis the Life of Abraham Lincoln. And it's the kind of a book you should be reading instead of the whole love of the trash. Them all now is about love and romance that has you and Lizzie Casey and the rest of you like yeah.
Lizzie Casey. Lord service, if I ever lost my senses and married that star,
I suppose she'd expect me to go out every night and sing Rosie McCantor under the moon. Why, that wouldn't I look well.
I was reading a grand story last night, Uncle Michael.
Yeah?
And it reminded me nothing of yourself and Lizzie. There was this woman, she fell in love with a man. We wouldn't have her at all. She kept trying for 40 years. It was all the same. In one day, the doctor told him he'd only 6 months to live. Well, what do you think he did? He didn't like this girl at all, but he knew she was in love with him, and didn't he marry her?
Did you?
You knew he'd only 6 months to live, so he decided he'd sacrifice himself to make the poor thing happy for once in her life.
Well, I hope he did die.
I don't know. I didn't read the last chapter yet.
You needn't bother reading it. If he didn't die natural death, he committed suicide.
Heavens, Uncle Michael, getting married isn't as bad as all that.
Listen, old girlie. I can see where this conversation is drifting. But I give you one warning. If you mention Lizzie Casey to me again, I'll put you across my knee and I'll give you the greatest scalping you ever got in your life.
All right, but mind you.
Did you hear what I said?
I better leave you alone.
Where are you going?
I'm going for a walk with Lizzie Casey.
Michael, come back here. You said a minute ago that this country needed another Abraham Lincoln. Well, if you ask me, it's another Father Matthew at once. You were just going off to fill yourself and your friends with Leonard's filthy porter. Day in, day out, it's the same old story. You come in from work, and before your tea has time to reach your stomach, you're off to the public house.
I was going up to the chapel to say a few prayers. And you'll have the satisfaction of knowing that you prevented me. Every day for the past 35 years I've been going up there after my tea to say a few prayers every evening. And this is the first evening that I'd have missed that habit. I hope you feel proud of yourself.
Prayers indeed. The patron saint of the chapel, you were going to have the red nose.
Well, that's a nice how do you do. A fellow can't even go out to say his prayers now.
Your Anne Mary is a suspicious mind.
And she doesn't keep her suspicions herself either. But I'm damned if I leave a woman's tongue stand between me and my eternal salvation. I'm going for the she likes it or not.
Don't forget to say one for me, Uncle Michael.
Oh, so you don't believe me either? Well, you can think what you like. Thanks be to God, my religion is strong enough for the two of you.
He's gone, I see. Won't it be grand to have a canonized saint in the family?
There's someone at the door. I see who it is.
This gentleman wants to see you, Anne Mary. Good evening.
Good evening, Mrs. Shannon.
Miss Shannon, if you don't mind.
I thought you looked sensible right enough. I must have picked it up wrong.
Who are you?
Henry's the name, Peter Sebastian Henry, and I'm representing the Raven Publishing Company.
What do you want?
Oh, it's not something I want, Miss Shannon, it's something you want.
What are you talking about?
Miss Shannon, I have here a book on which every housewife in the country needs. And the title is The Complete Household Encyclopedia. It contains information on every domestic subject under the sun.
It appears to be a very heavy volume, Mr. Henry. Don't waste your energy, take it out, because I don't want it.
There's a section on gardening, a section on first aid, a section on household repairs. You have absolutely no idea how useful this book can be.
Mr. Henry, I don't want it. I've been keeping house for over 30 years, and I don't need a book to tell me what to do.
If you break a window, it tells you how to repair it. If you sprain your ankle, it tells you how to mend it. If on the paper the parlour tells you how to do so without making a mess of it. It tells you how to keep milk from getting sour. It tells you how to wash delicate garments. And it even tells you how to mince punters on a bicycle.
Mr. Henry, I never break windows. I never sprain my ankle. My brother does all the papering. I know how to keep milk from going sour. I haven't worn delicate garments since I was 12 years old, and I never ride a bicycle.
It contains thousands of labour-saving hints. When you get it, you'll wonder how you ever manage without it.
You talk a hole through a pot.
There's a section on pot mending, isn't it? There's something about everything. It's the most amazing value in the world for £15.
£15?
And cheap at that price. You know, I was talking to a lady who bought them for me the other day, and she said it was the widest £15 she ever spent. She said it was worth double the money. If only for one thing, it kept her husband out of the public house at night. Well, he looked through the book, and he found simple methods of doing hundreds of little jobs around the house. He discovered that he was such a handy chap, after all. Now he spends all his evenings at home, instead of going to the pub. You have no husband, Miss Shannon, but I thought I'd tell you that.
I have no husband, Mr. Henry, but I have a brother who fits into the picture very well, and I should very much like to be able to keep him out of the public houses at night. But I'm afraid your book wouldn't be of much use. Besides, it's none of your business.
I suppose not, but wouldn't it be worth trying at the same time?
Young man, if I thought there was the slightest chance, I'd buy a dozen of your precious books. But I know my brother, and I can assure you that if he had to make a choice between household repairs and Guinness's stout, he'd give Guinness his first, second, third, and fourth vote.
The same drink is a terrible thing too, Miss Shannon.
It's the seven deadly sins rolled into one. And you think you're of it?
No, I wouldn't say that at all. I knew a chap who was a hopeless drunkard for years. And now he walks on the opposite side of the street when he sees the Guinness advertisement.
How was he cured?
As a matter of fact, it was I cured him.
You? How?
That's something I couldn't be telling you. If that was ever found out, I'd have to grow a beard or wear a steel-breasted plaid.
Well, I wish you'd try it on my brother, whatever it was. If you cured him from drinking, I'd buy two of your books. One for the kitchen fire and one for the fire in my bedroom.
You must be crazy, Miss Shannon, but mind you, I put you on him.
You have a standing invitation to try.
This is getting interesting. Yes, this is getting very interesting. You snore?
No.
I don't mind if I snore?
No.
If I told your brother, would you buy two of my books?
Yes.
I'm inclined to take on with the assignment. Where's your brother?
He isn't far away.
Right. Let me along with him for 15 minutes, and I'll turn him into the dry seat officer and God's earth.
I'd love to know how, Mr. Henry.
You get your brother, and I'll do the rest.
Okay. Maureen?
Will you run out and find Mikey and Jerry? He's the chap, isn't he, Emily?
Yes.
Of course, Miss Shannon, this is the understanding that you'll buy two of my books if I'm successful.
Oh, yes.
Well, right. I'm going to try to take on with that assignment. Where's your brother?
Did you want me, Mary?
Yes, Mike. This is Dr. Henry. He came all the way from Dublin to see you.
To see me?
Yes, Mr. Shannon. Your sister Tasha wasn't looking well at all lately, so she sent for me. We're all friends, you know.
She thought I wasn't looking well. What the hell is she talking about? I'm on as strong and as healthy as a horse.
There's no need to get excited, Mr. Shannon. You better leave us alone, Miss Shannon. Sit down there, my good man, and calm yourself.
I won't sit down here. I'm better understand than you are. Oh, what the flaming fiddlesticks is this all about? Do you mean to tell me that the hunt's in for you to come down here to examine me?
That's just what she did.
Ah, she's stop staring, mother one.
That's right, Mr. Shannon. Sit down and take it easy, eh?
I'm sitting here because I want to sit here, not because you asked me to. And you really mean that she sent for you to come down here to examine me? Well, I think she must be mad, there's no doubt about it.
Look here, Mr. Shannon, your sister did a very sensible thing in sending for me. Very often, a person's ill health is obvious to everyone except himself. Evidently, your sister noticed little symptoms of ill health that had escaped you yourself. As a matter of fact, the moment you came in the door, I could see you were far from being well. Your eyes looked tired and there was a general nervousness about you.
Yes, yes, yes. You'll be seeing me for a priest in a minute.
It's a fact. No, don't let us waste any more time. Take off your coat.
For what?
I'd like to give you a brief look over.
Listen, lad. If you think you're going to start pumping my chest, you're mistaken. The best thing you could do now is take your baggage and flip it back to wherever you came from. I don't need no doctor. I'm a fine, healthy, strong fellow in the prime of my youth.
Look here, Mr. Shannon. Send me no trouble at all for me to take my bag and to walk out of here. Your sister has paid me my fee in advance, and if you refuse to let me examine you, well, that's not my fault. But your sister and I are all friends, and I don't think to be fair to walk out now without a struggle. And if you had any sense of gratitude, you'd only be too anxious to cooperate. After all, it's for your heart that you've been trying to trouble and explain.
But my good man, I'm as fit as a fiddle.
If you're as fit as a fiddle, I'll tell you so, and that would be dangerous.
I think the whole damn lot of your man. Come on. Let's get it over.
Just a moment now. I'd like to get some information on your background. For instance, where do you work?
I work in a mill for an hour bearing slave driver called Macmillan.
Just so. Do you live here alone?
No, my sister came to work for me.
You have only one sister?
Oh, that's all, thanks be to God.
And who's the other young lady that was here?
Oh, she's my niece, Marlene Shannon.
Marlene Shannon. Where does she live?
About a mile down the road.
Down the road? In what direction, Mr. Shannon?
In that direction. The first house beyond the bridge. What the hell has she got to do with my help?
My good man, I've visited many years studying the complications of medicine. And surely you don't expect me to divulge the secret surgery on Amir.
All right, what else do you want to know about her?
She's not married.
No, and as far as I know, she has no prospects. Do you want to feel her pulse?
No. I think we've enough to be going on with now. Let me see.
Find anything wrong?
The last time you saw a doctor, did he say anything about your heart?
He did. He said to
drive
a 6-day watch.
Just as I thought.
He gave me 6 months
to live. Oh,
fool. He
must
have been listening to
Don
Hartley
Gate
within 2 weeks.
Look here, Mr. Shannon. He wasn't such an old fool at all. You're a good, sensible man in the world, and I know you don't like people beating around the bush with you. So I'm going to be frank and tell you, man to man, what your condition is.
Do you know how long ago that was? When he gave me 6 months to live? 34 years last January.
As I was saying, Mr. Shannon, he wasn't a fool at all. And to make a long story short, if you continue in your present way, you'll be inside your grave inside 3 weeks.
3 weeks?
Do you agree?
You really think that... You really mean to stand there and tell me that I'd be my grave within 3 weeks?
Do you drink?
I'm not drunk.
What do you mean by not drunk? Every night?
Oh, no, no, not every... No, not every night. I said I'm going to a pub on a Thursday.
Just as I thought. My good man, you were suffering from a particularly fatal heart disease brought about by the consumption of intoxicating drink. And to make a long story short, if you continue in your present way, you'll be inside your grave inside 3 weeks.
3 weeks, you said? I thought you were going to give me head on another 34 years, didn't you?
Mr. Shannon, I have done my duty. It makes no difference to me what you believe. It is your heart, your life.
I suppose you expect me to believe you. And have you come down here 3 or 4 times every week at about 5 or 6 pounds a time? You'll waste your time with that. The best thing you could do now is get your training and get out of here.
I know it is a hard thing to believe, Mr. Shannon, but I can assure you it's a fact. I have devoted nearly all my time as a doctor to the study of the human heart. And I know a bad case when I see one. This disease is not like other diseases. Today you're as fit as a fiddle, tomorrow you're as dead as a doornail. Just like that, snap, and out goes the candle.
Like I said before, if you don't get out of here before I lose what's left of my temper, snap and out goes the candle. You just snap off the head out of here.
I'm afraid you're mistaken, my poor man. I'm not trying to sponge me out of you. As a matter of fact, if I came down here every day, the fact still remains, you're a doomed man. Oh, you can refuse to believe it if you like. It makes no difference to me. I have done my duty, so I'll bid you good evening.
Come back here a minute. Sit down again, doctor. I'm sorry if I was rough with you. But you know, I was always a bit worried about my heart. And lately, I thought I was getting a bit excitable. If I stopped drinking and led a very easy life, how long do you think I'd stick it?
I'm afraid you wouldn't last very long in any event, Mr. Shannon. But I tell you what, you stop drinking and live a quite easy life, and I'll call around in the fastness to have another look at you.
I'll do that, Doctor.
Right. Well, I'm sorry to have to cause you so much anxiety, Mr. Shannon, but it's always better to stand up to things. Keep your chin up, Mr. Shannon.
No man ever saw Mick Shannon's chin down yet. I'm not afraid of going, but I'm a bit unhealthy at the same time.
That's only natural, Mr. Shannon. Well, good evening.
Good evening, Doctor. Mary!
What did
you
see?
Oh, not much. Mary, I think I'll go up to bed. I feel a bit tired. Will you bring me up about the supper?
I will.
And I think I won't go to work at all in the morning. I'll take it easy.
All right, Michael. Whatever you wish.
Good night, Mary.
Good night, Michael.
Good night, Marion.
Good night, Michael. I don't know what on earth has come over that man. He hasn't been at work now for 3 days. Did he go to the theater? No. I told him that Mr. Macmillan would sack him if he doesn't go tomorrow, but he says he doesn't care.
There's something queer about it all. He looks as well as ever.
God forgive me, but I think it's his mind that's gone. He sits here at times reading the Bible. Then he starts talking to himself. And last night I came in and found him gazing at a photograph of Lizzie Casey that he found upstairs. He held out the photo like this, and then says he, I wonder if I could put up with you for 3 weeks. Maureen, I think the poor fellow's beginning to dote.
He doesn't go near the public house either.
No. That might be the cause of it. He drank a lot, and the sudden change might affect his mind.
Yeah, he should have it stopped by degrees.
Maybe if he took an odd bottle of stout, he'd come back to normal. Yes, that's an idea. Do you know what I'll do, Maureen? I'll run up and get a bottle of stout and have it for him when he comes in to his tea. Will you stay here till I come back?
Certainly.
And if he comes in the meantime, don't tell him where I'm gone.
All right.
Since I cried before.
Were you crying, Uncle Michael? For what?
Oh, I'm crying, Marie, because it's such a grand evening. Ah, but you wouldn't understand. When you go out and see the sun go down and the whole country in a mist, you don't take any notice of it. It's just too grand evening. There'll be many more like it for you to come. But when I go out and see the sun go down, I only think of when I see it go down for the last time. Oh, you have no idea what Marlene.
Oh, Marlene, what on earth are you talking about, Todd?
Marlene, I'm going to die.
Oh, for God's sake, don't say things like that.
To the fact, the specialist told me. He said I was suffering from an incurable heart disease and I had only 3 weeks to live.
But he couldn't mean it.
Well, I didn't believe him at first either, but now I know it's true. Ah, don't be putting yourself out for me, Gillian. Marlene, don't be worrying yourself for me. Should we all have to go sometime? I know. Marlene, don't be worrying yourself because of me.
Did you tell her, Mary?
No, Gillian, I wouldn't tell her at all. She'll know soon enough.
But you'll have to tell her. Maybe something could be done. Maybe she could get a better doctor.
No, I'm done for. If I had the misfortune of telling her I'd die 1,000 times instead of once.
Oh, it's terrible, terrible. Can anything be done at all?
Nothing at all, dear Liam. I'll just have to wait my own, make my peace with God, and do my best. Ah, don't be worrying, Uncle. Audience, we all have to go sometime. I wouldn't have told you at all, but it's a great comfort for me to know that somebody else knows it as well as myself. Myself and the man above are always fairly good friends. I tell you, I have a few jobs to do though before I go. And I want you to help me.
I need to be sure.
Well, I don't think you could help me with the first one.
What's that?
It is a little bit of business I have to settle with my boss, Macmillan.
Oh, don't bother your head about him.
Oh, be dads, I'll bother my head about him. I wouldn't do myself out of one of my last pleasures of life. That fella, the way he's been treating us at that mill. You know what happened last week? You know young Malai, that's working there?
Yeah.
The poor lad, he came in some morning and he jaded tired. He had been up all night at old Finnegan's wake. And about 12 o'clock, he sat down to have a bit of a smoke. Up comes Macmillan, never said a word at all, but raised up his big palm, slapped the fag out of the young lad's mouth, and told him to get back to work or he'd find himself outside the gate. Of course, the young lad explained that he was tired and he had been up the night before. Do you know what Macmillan said? Himself wasn't paying for this for staying up and wakes. Now, wouldn't that drive any Christian mad?
Well, if you say anything to him, he'll sack you.
Oh, that doesn't matter. I have enough to keep me going for the time I've left. Oh, be God, I'm going to let him have it hot and heavy. He's coming down here this evening, I sing for it.
Come here?
Yeah. I invited him to the tea. I told him I had a few bits of business to talk about. And I'm telling you that between the first and second cups, I'll tell that fellow something that'll put the hair standing on his head like a headshot.
You better not say much between the second one and the third one. He might say something that'll make the hair stand new head.
Marty, not between the second and third. Oh, gee, I wouldn't give that fellow 3 cups of tea if I was the Viceroy of India.
I suppose it's all you're trying to talk out of it.
No good. As I said, it is one of my last pleasures in life and I'm not going to deprive myself of it.
You said there were other bits of business to be done too.
There is, but I must think that over for a while yet. Do you know what you could do for me? Run over to Lizzie Casey's and get her to come down here. Don't let her know that I sit for you. Whatever you do, just, you know, the usual way, get her to come down. And don't let her anything.
Do you want me to go now?
You might as well, because it will take you a good while, and I'll have Macmillan off my chest by the time that you get back. Together. Ah, it is well I remember all the fun we had. What a game it was indeed. But sure, it was all in the game, everything we did, Macmillan. You know, Macmillan, The first thing that I'm going up against today, I have a few things to do. And I'm very glad that you arrived to give me strength. Because you know, Macmillan, well, he knows you anyway. He's coming down here today. And I'm going to give him a bit of my mind that I've promised with the last 30 years. But before I go on to that, let's look back over some of the times we've had together. Will you ever forget the night at Julia's wedding when you made me go dancing with that bow-legged one? What a night we had. But I'll tell you one thing I never forgot for you. When you sang me to sleep under the bush at Kelly's, and the goat came along and made streelers out of my new hat. I told you what I thought I'd do that night. Still, Fitzgibbon, tis all in the game, but I'm afraid the game is nearly over. Any minute now, the referee will blow his whistle and I might have to leave the field. But there's something else I'm so pleased that you came along to help me out with. Do you know Lizzie Casey? Yeah, I sure you do, of course. Don't you remember the one? That's right, you get the best of you at the wedding, and you scattered her over half an acre of the kitchen floor. That big one. Well, you know, this very day I'm going to ask that one to marry me. Now, don't fall off the chair for it, you know, but the whole thing is this. You know, Marlene was telling me about the story that she read about this old fella. He was happy as Larry, like myself. But he had been pestered for years by this one, waiting for the first slip of his tongue so that she could say, I will. Anyway, he got 6 months to live, and you know what he did? He married her. Well, that's what put it into my mind. You see, there's something about women, Fitzgibbon, that they always like to be able to say they got their man. Still, I suppose I might as well make the poor old creature happy. If this is the last thing I do, I might as well serve my purgatory here as later on.
My dear, Mr. Macmillan's coming up to the door. It must be you he wants.
What is me he wants? All right, I sent for him.
You sent for him?
I did. I told him I had a bit of business to discuss with him. And while you're at it too, Mary, bring up an extra cup. He'll be staying for the tea.
My dear Shannon, are you leaving your mind? Did you ask Mr. Macmillan to come here without telling me and the state the house is in?
Tis good enough for that whole idiot. He'll be along now in a minute.
Such a thing to do, you might have told me.
Poor Fitzgibbon knows the time. Now we're in for it, and I give that fellow what he deserves. Good evening, Mr. Macmillan.
Good evening, Shannon.
Sit down and make yourself at home.
No, thank you, Shannon. I have not time to spare. What do you want to see me about?
Oh, that little bit of business will wait and well sorted. Sit down and relax yourself.
I tell you, Shannon, I'm a busy man. I have other things to attend to, you know.
My, oh my, but is a busy man you are.
Look here, man. This rigmarole is all right in its own place, but I'm a busy man, and I can't afford to waste all my time here. Will you please come to the point? Why did you ask me to come here?
I have a few words to say to you.
Well, for heaven's sake, say them.
All right, Macmillan, I will say them.
Did you call me Macmillan?
And you call me Shannon since you came in.
Be careful, Shannon. Be very careful.
My dear man, I've been careful with you for the past 30 years. I invited you down here this evening to tell you something that I've been dying to tell you since I first set eyes on your ugly clock. Sit down there and listen to me. Why, gee, you're going to hear me out even if I have to get into that chair. You're going to hear me telling you what an ugly, bully, stuck-up old pig you are.
Shannon, do you realize what you're saying?
I do realize it. And I realized that it's now I should be saying it, but 30 years ago. For 30 years, you've been treating the men at the mill and myself just like dogs.
and all we ever got from you outside of bad wages was impudence and bad manners. You didn't even have the good manners to be polite to us. Sit down and listen to me.
Don't shout at me, you drunken imbecile. If you think I'm going to sit there and let an uneducated galoot like you insult me, you're mistaken. Nor will I lower my dignity by attempting to argue with you. So I bid you good evening, Mr. Shannon, and goodbye. It is hardly necessary for me to inform you that you are no longer in my employment.
Michael Shannon, you're stark staring mad. Did you hear what you said to Mr. Macmillan?
I did, and I hope he had the tooth. Silly old sonny laughed out at me before I got right started.
What's wrong with you at all?
There's nothing wrong with me, Mary. I stopped your old whinging.
But he's after sacking you.
It doesn't matter.
Why doesn't it matter?
It just doesn't matter.
What's wrong? Everything's wrong, Maureen, child. If you were heard what that uncle of yours is after saying to Mr. Macmillan.
I said, yeah, Martin. If you had what I didn't say to him, you'd have something to say.
What car is this about? Who brought the cough?
Oh, he bumped into her when she was bringing the shop for the care of the old elephant.
Why is it that God has given me so much trouble?
Come down and have a cup of tea, said Mary. Make you feel better. Lizzie Casey's down
in
the kitchen. Lizzie Casey? When did she come in? I
hope
she didn't hear all that was going on.
No, she's just in. I got Lizzie, all right, Uncle Michael. Will I send her up to you?
No, not yet. You're being wet. They're cool down.
Did you say much to Macmillan?
Not half as much as I wanted to say to him. He walked out to me before I got started, but he got a good idea what I meant.
Poor Aunt Mary was very upset. I still think you ought to tell us what it's all about.
No, Gilly, they won't tell us. Soon enough, she'd know.
What did she think of it at all? First of all, you lose your job, and now you're going to ask Lizzie Casey to marry you. She'd think you've gone mad.
Maybe I'm mad. Maybe you would be mad too if I had, you had only 3 weeks to live. The silly old Egypt when he keep in mind himself and let me die for my king, Jim. What made you think I was going to ask Lizzie Casey to marry me?
The man in the book, Uncle Michael. The man in the book. But honestly, what did poor Aunt Mary think? She'd think you're off your nut.
Well, as I say, maybe you'd be off your nut too if you were in my position. Well?
Don't let it upset you, Uncle Michael.
What upset me at all? And Lizzie's down the kitchen. Listen, what did they fall in the book, sir?
Well, whatever you do, don't tell her the real reason why you're going to marry her. Pretend that you love her and that you always want her to be near you. Do you know all the usual stuff? Tell her you like the colour of her eyes and her hair.
Do you want me to face my creator with my soul blackened with lies?
God won't mind. Every woman likes to be told these things, especially by someone she loves.
Well, how could I tell her that I like the colour of her hair when it makes me sassy? and the colour of her eyes? They remind me of something I saw in a bad dream. Now, if her hair was as nice as yours and her eyes as brown, it would be a pleasure. But we're talking about Lizzie Casey. Elizabeth Casey.
Well, if you want to make her happy, you might as well do it right.
All right, all right. So long as they don't have to sing to her.
The man in the book thanked her. Uncle Michael, you don't understand women at all. There's not one bard who doesn't like a bit of romance. Most of them get it. But if you like Lizzie Casey, you're passed over. Do your best, Uncle Michael, and make the poor thing happy for once in her life.
Marion, you're a grand little girl. And I hope that you'll meet the fellow that will tell you what a lovely girl you are.
Maybe he will.
You know I have a secret to tell you. Do you know the fellow that examined me, the specialist?
I saw him, but I know who he was at the time.
Why, God, and he was very interested in you. You know, he wanted to let on, he wanted to find out about my background and all the rest of it, but I knew well what he was leading up to. He was really interested in you, and he'll be coming back here in about 2 weeks' time. And if I were you, I wouldn't be far away when he does come.
Maybe you'll just be inquisitive. I'll send up Lizzie.
Do
do that here?
Oh, Fitzgibbon, Fitzgibbon! Don't leave me in this awful hour.
Good evening, Lizzie.
Good evening.
Come in, sit down. It is a grand day here. Maybe the weather might pick up a bit now.
Good
night. We could do a bit now for the harvest.
We could indeed, Mike.
We had no summer at all, Lizzie.
Can't
we? How's your mother?
Oh, she's friendly, sir.
Over the bathroom, isn't she, glad?
She's not indeed.
Oh, well, the health isn't anything after all.
It is my too.
And head of hair you got there, Lizzie?
What do you
think? I said, that's a grand head of hair you got. And you got the two nicest days I ever saw in a woman's head. They're lovely, so they are.
Isn't that
me,
you are, Michael? What do you want me to do for you?
Oh, I don't want you to do nothing for me, Lizzie. I'm only just telling you what any man with two eyes and a head can do. To the truth.
When I was brought up yet, you never bothered with me. And now I'm an old woman, and you're telling me I have beautiful eyes and lovely hair. My eyes are like your own, Michael, as grey as ashes. And my hair is like yours, too. Oh, why did you tell me these things 40 years ago? God knows, I want to hear them then, but I'm afraid it's a bit late now.
Oh, it's not a bit late at all, is it? Sure, you're still a fine young girl and I'm a young man.
Oh, there's many a silver thread among the girls all the same way.
Darling, darling, silver threads among the gold, shine upon my brow today. Life is fading fast away, but my darling, you will be always young and fair to me. Always young and fair to me.
Mike, this is making love to you.
I'm asking you to marry me. And it has nothing. Come back here a minute. I'm asking you to marry me, but it has nothing to do with the bill. You never told me whether you would marry me or not.
Mike is there. Can you not see it in my eyes?
Silver threads among the gold. Lord, that must wouldn't have been an awful way, no fair, did you, Jane?
I can't believe he's getting married in the morning. They used to say women had queer minds, but that man would leave them all in the shade. The first thing he does after getting the sack is to ask Lizzie to marry him.
And Mary, did he not tell you why he's getting married?
No. Has he any special reason?
He has. He told me not to tell you, but I have to tell you.
Well, tell me.
He's going to die.
What did you say?
I'm going to die.
What are you saying at all?
It's a fact. He told me not to tell you, but I couldn't keep the secret any longer. You know, the specialist that was here the other evening told me it only 3 weeks to live.
A specialist? What specialist?
Don't you remember?
Oh, I know. Maureen, my poor girl, don't be wasting your tears on him. He's not going to die. The specialist, as you call him, was only pulling his leg.
Pulling his leg?
I see the whole thing now. And the idiot went and got himself sacked.
And really, I don't know what you're talking about.
I'll tell you. First of all, that specialist was no more a specialist than I am. He came in here to try to sell me a book on how to wash delicate garments or something. We got talking about husbands, then about brothers, and to make a very long story short, he guaranteed to cure Michael of drinking if I'd buy some of his books. Don't you see? He pretended he was a doctor and must have told Michael he'd be dead in 3 weeks if he didn't stop drinking. It would be funny if it hadn't turned out so serious. The poor fool believed him and started behaving like a lunatic. And Uncle Michael was going to die after all. He lived to be 99 and a half.
We'd better tell him quickly. Where is he?
Maureen, sit down now for a minute.
But I want to tell him. The poor man suffered long enough.
Well, I think he's going to suffer longer.
What do you mean? Are we not going to tell him?
Not yet. What do you think would happen if we told him now?
Nothing would happen. He'd be delighted.
And what about Lizzie Casey? Do you think he'd tie himself to her if he found out he wasn't going to die?
But you wouldn't want him to marry her under false pretenses.
Maureen, the whole parish knows that Michael and Lizzie are to be married in the morning. In fact, the whole country knows it. Now, wouldn't Lizzie be in a nice predicament if Michael backed out now? She'd be the laughing stock of Ireland.
Aren't we in a nice fix? That was a rotten trick to play on poor Uncle Michael.
But Maureen, dear, I didn't know what that rascal was going to tell him.
3 weeks to live. And now he's almost married and lost his job. Waiting that still comes around here ever again. He'll not leave in one piece. What on earth are we going to do?
I think we should let him get married. Lizzie's a good woman, and she'll look after him well. I've made arrangements to leave anyway. Yes, I think the best thing to do is to let him go ahead with the wedding and then tell him.
But there'll be holy war.
But what else can we do? Then I'll go up to Mr. Macmillan and explain things to him. And maybe he'd give Michael his job again. Although I doubt that. The things he said to him. You're very late, Michael.
I know.
I think you should go on to bed. Remember, you have to be up early in the morning.
And you mustn't be late in the morning. You shouldn't do to keep poor Lizzie waiting. And I'm sure she'll be sore as the chapel opens.
If she doesn't pitch a tint that night and sleep on the steps.
Are you nervous?
No, not a bit. As a matter of fact, no, Maureen, you know, tis tonight I'm supposed to die.
Oh, no. You've another while yet.
Ah, but what good is it? Tis a kind of a suspended animation. God, you know, but tis an awful world, too. Tis only when you're going to die that you realize the things in this life that you have missed. God be with the days when I was a fine, hefty, healthy man. Why the devil didn't I enjoy myself when I had the opportunity? Ah, but sure, you wouldn't understand it. You're too young to understand things like that, man. For the past week now, I cleared my soul of every debt and obligation that I had. And now I'm about the only fellow in this parish with a clear conscience. And I have to tell you. Ah, it's a queer place, man. Well, I suppose there isn't any hope as far as you think. But I can assure you, I hope there isn't. Because if I thought there was any hope, do you think that I'd put the ring on the one that I'm putting it on in the morning? No way whatsoever. But I'll tell you what, if I had anything to give to you, Marian, you'd be the first to get it. But I'll tell you something that'll be worth £1,000 to you. If you live every minute as if 'twas your last, and do everything good in life, you'll be the happiest girl in the world. If every man, woman, and child got a taste of death when they were young, there'd be no quarreling or fighting or blood spilling for things that didn't matter at all. But like I said before, how could I expect you to understand that? You're too young.
Why don't you keep on hoping that you won't die?
Didn't I tell you? Keep hoping that I won't die? Do you really think that I'd put a ring on her if I was going to be sure that I wouldn't die? No. As a matter of fact, no, I hope the specialist was right and that I will die.
But supposing when the specialist came back, he told you that you want to live after all?
I'd get another specialist. And be Jeff, he didn't give me my passport, I'd die of some other disease.
Michael, before you go to bed, I think you ought to go through the wedding ceremony, just in case you make a mistake in the morning.
I'll be making mistakes in the morning, no matter what I do.
Last night, Charles, the night before your wedding. Come over here now and have some performance with myself and Maureen.
Why, God, do a man get any rest at all in his last night of freedom?
No. Imagine Maureen is
located. Not in my wife's dreams of fancy.
Maureen, you stand as well. You might as well, of course. No. When you walk to the altar, that's the way you will be. The best man and the bridesmaid will be standing right behind you. You will be kneeling, of course. Now, the priest will tell you to hold Lizzie's hand. And then he'll ask if you, Michael Shannon, will take Elizabeth Casey here to be thy lawful wedded wife or something like that. And you say you will.
Why, dear, don't it very much. I tell you, sure, my common sense will get the better of me. When I see the horn in the morning with a big flowy hat, a bunch of rhododendrons sprouting out of her left shoulder, my common sense is bound to get the better of me, and I leave her a flow to all at the altar.
Come over here, and none of you not. Get
what kind of a... What kind of a court? How did I even consult it? What kind of an idiot was the terrible who made it at all? It's all behind the night, of course. Have your white pants to go with it?
No.
Would you like to see me? Just get me a white pants with it, Noah, and they have it in Lawful Gazette, the marriage of the century. It won't be in the marriage column, it will be in the zoology column. Penguin marries elephant.
Now, after that, the priest will tell you to repeat some words after him. And then...
He'll be looking if I don't repeat them before him.
And then you'll be told to put on your ring. You on the third finger of her left hand. The priest will tell you anyway. And don't be awkward about it.
Don't be awkward about it. You don't think I put on a big child, you know. All right, what's next?
That's all, I think.
Thanks, Pete.
After that, then, you have to go into the chapter and sign the priest's book.
I got him the wise man in tea, letting me put it in writing.
I'm going to come out of the chapter, Uncle Michael. You have to kiss the bride. I'd better go home and get some sleep, Annette. I'll see you in the morning.
All right, Morris.
Good night. Are you happy, Michael?
Oh, I'm as happy as Larry.
So am I. I was nearly giving up hope of you. But I suppose all's well that isn't well.
I suppose so. Any sign of my tea?
I was waiting for your sister, Maureen. They said they'd be over this evening. You don't mind waiting?
No, not a bit.
Of course, if we want it, I get it, you.
What is all right? It's all right. Time enough.
Are you sure now?
I'm stuck.
Dear, it's a long time since you had your dinner. Maybe I'll make it to you.
No, don't bother, because of me.
Maybe you'll have a bit of snuff while you're waiting, I think. To be good for you.
Snuff? Will that be here soon, do you think?
You must be very hungry. Do you know I make a cup for you?
I know, don't bother about me. I'm all right. I've got a bit hungry.
Are you sure?
Absolutely.
Still, it might be a long time before they come. I think I'll wait.
No, it's all right.
Will you have a poached egg or anything while you're waiting, Michael?
No, it's all right. Don't bother about me, Lizzie.
Sure.
Positive. Positive. Positive.
All right, we'll wait. Oh, that must be them now.
I'm like some for the wedding for the league.
Michael, you're wanted down at the mill quick.
At the mill? What's wrong?
I don't know. The men went on strike because Macmillan sacked you and there's terrible trouble. Go on down quick.
We've got to go down, so on, see what's up.
I'm coming with you, Michael.
Oh, where would you be going?
Michael, my place is by your side. Remember, we said for better for worse.
Listen, woman. You just stay there where you are.
No, it's my duty to go. Mary, you come too. Maureen, you stay in mind the house till I come back.
All right.
Farewell, farewell to the sitting sun. Farewell, farewell to the golden world. Farewell, farewell, for my day is done. And sadly at sunset, my flag is furled.
Farewell, farewell to the spreading oak beneath whose shade we sang our song. Farewell, farewell to the comrade foe. Farewell, farewell to the passing song.
Do you usually walk into houses without even knocking?
I met Mr. Shannon at the door and he told me to come in. May I sit down?
Too.
Thank you. It was a nice evening.
Cheers.
It was a nice day, eh?
It was.
You know, I don't seem to be very welcome around here.
You ought to be ashamed of yourself.
Oh dear, have I been a bad boy?
Why did you tell Uncle Mike that he's only 3 weeks today?
Oh, that surely. That didn't do him any harm. It is a good thing for a man to think he's going to die. It makes him behave himself.
It makes him do many things.
Why? What did your uncle do?
Oh, he merely told off his boss. Lost his job.
Lost his job? Oh, I'm sorry, but I didn't think he'd do anything like that.
Wait until I tell you the rest. Thinking that he'd only 3 weeks before, he went and married Lizzie Casey.
He got married? Oh my God! What have I done? And who is Lizzie Casey? Don't tell me she's a flying fractus. I saw her at the door.
That's Lizzie.
couldn't one of you have fallen to all the hawks before he made such an accident?
I didn't know it was a hoax till it was too late. I thought you were a doctor, and Mary was the only one who knew who you were, and Uncle Michael didn't tell her.
And does he know now?
No, we were afraid to tell him.
Well, I'd better tell him myself before he does any more damage.
Are you married?
No.
Have you anyone depending on you?
No.
You can tell him for like.
Mr. Henry, I hurried back as soon as I could to see you. Do you realize what you've done?
I have a rough idea.
And aren't you ashamed of yourself?
The only emotion of which I'm capable at this moment is an overwhelming feeling of pity. But that poor man that married Lizzie Casey?
Well, you'd better keep all your pity for yourself. Because you're going to tell him that it was all a joke.
I suppose I'll have to. Will he take it back, you think?
He'll probably break every bone in your body. But maybe your precious book will tell you how to fix broken bones, too.
There's no need to rub it in, Miss Shannon. It was my fault. I thought of his thing in hands, joking him, and it misfired. I'll explain the whole thing to him. Then, if he breaks every bone in my body, I'll have them reset at my own expense. I'll even go to his boss and tell him what happened. Maybe he'll have a sense of humor and give me his job back.
I don't think you'll have to go to all that trouble. Michael himself has just gone up to Mr. Macmillan. The men at the mill went on strike and won't go back unless Michael gets his job again. There's a deputation gone to Macmillan and Michael's gone with him.
And where's Lizzie? She's gone with the deputation too. She refused to leave him.
The poor man.
Between you and me and the gatepost, Mr. Henry, I'm glad he married Lizzie Casey. But if he doesn't get his job back, well, when Michael has finished breaking every bone in your body, I'll start making pulp with him.
And then this young lady here can put him in an urn and cremate him. Oh, what charming people you are.
3 weeks to live. Some of the young gentlemen of the rising generation are too smacked for words.
Ah, well, I suppose I might as well be happy for my last few moments in this, This form seems to be acting quite a few places. Farewell, farewell to the passing song. Farewell, farewell to the comrade foe. Farewell, farewell to my days done. Farewell, farewell. Farewell, farewell to the tender flowers. Farewell, farewell to the gentle rain. Farewell, farewell on ye happy hours. Farewell till we meet again. Ah well, I'm not married, and I have no dependents. I'll not be missed.
I wouldn't like to see you getting all your bones broken all the same. You're so young.
Sad, isn't it?
There's a way out, don't you know?
Oh, suicide?
You're very funny, but there's a simple way out of it.
Oh, I'm dying to hear it.
Can't you keep on pretending that you're a doctor? Examine him again and say that he'll live after all?
No. Couldn't work. I couldn't go around pretending I was a doctor for the rest of my days.
Why wouldn't it work? He believed you before, and he believed you again.
No. The best thing to do is to make a clean breast of it. Then, let him do his worst. If I'm still alive.
I can come and go without having to pretend anything.
You mustn't tend to be around here often.
Oh, I certainly do.
Here's my now, Mr. Henry. Maureen, come on down to the kitchen. This could be no place for a girl before very long. Good luck. You need it.
Oh, yes, let me like a soldier, guy. Good evening, Mr. Tennant.
Good evening, Doctor. I'm sorry I have kept you waiting, but I was a little troubled over the mill and I found myself in the middle of it.
Oh, dear, oh, dear. I hope everything is all right now.
Well, it isn't, it isn't. I tell you how it all happened. When you told me I had only 3 weeks to live, I went and gave Macmillan, the boss, a bit of my mind, and he fired me. Well, I expected he would anyway. Not that it didn't make any difference in the time I had left. But you know what happened? The men of the mill, they went on strike. They had a bit of a demonstration today, and
a deputation went to Macmillan. They told him they would go back to work until I got my job back.
And how did their fellows?
Oh, they're frightened the liver out of him. His wife made him give me my job back.
That's wonderful, Mr. Shannon. Oh, that reminds me. I believe I have to congratulate you on your marriage. Did I meet your missus with you when I met you on the team in the street some time ago?
Glad you couldn't help seeing her.
Now, now, Mr. Shannon, don't be catty. I'm sure both of you are very happy now that you got your job back.
Well, what damn good is my job to me? When I could die any day. Well, you know, Doctor, you have no idea what I've been through since you were here last. I died a thousand times. I died every time I saw the soot go down. Every time that I heard the engine swing, I thought of the day when I'd hear it for the last time. You know, Doctor, I died every time that I saw a friend that I know would be after me when I'm gone. You have no idea what I've suffered. I sure have died a thousand times. And I suppose I'll die another thousand before it really comes at me in the end. It is a terrible way to be.
Mr. Shannon, I have a confession to make.
Excuse me, Michael, but where's Lizzie? Didn't she come back with you?
No, Mary, she's still down arguing with Macmillan. You know, she's looking for £5 a week extra on my wages. And I had to laugh because she told Macmillan she'd starve on the wages he was giving me. He told her she could afford to starve for a month and we wouldn't miss nothing on. She'll be back in a minute.
As I was saying, Mr. Shannon, I have a confession to make.
A confession, Doctor? What can you a confession?
Mr. Shannon, I'm not a doctor at all.
What do you mean you're not a doctor?
I mean, just as I say, I'm not a doctor at all. I know nothing about medicine. And when I told you you had only 3 weeks to live, I was only pulling your leg.
Hold on a minute. Hold on. Stop digging there where you said I have a confession.
I'm trying to tell you I'm not a doctor. I came here about a fortnight ago to try to sell your sister a book on domestic economy. Somehow or other, the subject came around to drink. I guarantee to cure you from drinking if your sister will buy one of my books. Well, I printed it with the doctor. I don't know the rest. I'm sorry, Mr. Shannon, if my little joke has got you into any kind of a mess. I'm very sorry, Mr. Shannon, but I didn't think you'd do the mad things you have done. Ah, for heaven's sake, don't stand there staring at me. Say something. Tell me you'll break every bone in my body. Say something.
The complete household encyclopedia. Say something. For once in my life, I'm speechless.
I'm very sorry, Mr. Shannon, if my little joke has got you into any kind of a mess.
Your little joke? You call that a little joke? You call tying myself for the rest of my life to a, I don't know what to call it. You call that a little joke?
I said I was sorry, didn't I?
You're sorry, are you? Why, Jane, you'll be a damn sight sorrier before you leave here, lad. 3 weeks to live, and me making a blooming idiot of myself going wrong, reading poetry and doing this and that. You won't have a bond left before you leave this house. That's sure to you.
Don't shout, Mr. Shannon. Do you want Lizzie Casey to hear us?
I don't give a damn who hears me.
Ah, but if she knew the real reason how you married her, she wouldn't be very pleased now, would she?
I don't care whether she'd be pleased or not. Still, maybe it'd be better if she didn't know the reason. My God, if she ever found out that, I might as well pack my bag straight away. It would be a real murder after that. You know what, in spite of all your little jokes, if you mention to that one the reason I married her, you won't leave this house alive.
I don't know whether I will or not. After all, you're not being very nice to me, are you?
All right, I won't say nothing. You and your little joke.
'Twas a nice way to set me up, wasn't it?
You know, Mr. Shannon, you're behaving very strangely for a man that thought he wasn't going to die.
Going to die? What do you mean, going to die? Tying myself for the next half century to her? I don't think that I'd be happy because I'm not going to die.
Yeah, that thing down there now, we've got the chalk going down there here. And I really have my chips. Don't say that, you know, they'll be coming in a minute. I suppose. We want another, you think?
We let him come in. I'm still alive.
I was a boy, and I need it on your own. I'm sure he'll like it.
I'm glad to hear it.
A last minute inspiration saved me.
An inspiration?
Blackmail. I threatened to tell Lizzie Casey the real reason why he married her, so he let me off.
I thought of that myself too, and Mary said you'd be better not to tell her. So we're not going to tell her?
No.
Maureen, this is after getting Mr. Macmillan to make Michael a foreman with an extra £5 a week. She said she wouldn't let him go back to work except on those conditions. And if he didn't go back to work, the men would stay on strike. She's a great woman. I'd advise you to go while you're still all in one piece. Oh no, don't go yet. Stay and have a cup of tea. Uncle Michael won't be grudged to know that he's getting an extra £5 a week.
Oh, I'd love to stay.
The men used to do chasing in my day. Am I safe now?
I hope so.
Damn it, you know, Lizzie's not a bad old girl after all. She'll have to get him back, you know, to give me an extra £5 a week on my wages. If she keeps that up, I'll be able to return our team.
I don't know what to complain about, Mr. Shannon. Lizzie hasn't the figure of a snake, but she's a good, sensible woman, and she's looking after your house well.
Yes. Mind you, she hasn't the figure of a snake, as you say. Far from it. But if she keeps out of my way, feeds me well, things might be turned out too bad. I suppose you didn't mean you'd leave the job to turn up the way it is anyway. I suppose when she comes back from Macmillan, no, we'll hear all about it again. But still, £5 a week, you know, that's a bit of a that. That means a lot for him, that is me.
That's right, Mr. Shannon. And then you have this new family allowance.
I'm not interested in your family alone. And even if I was, I wouldn't be the only one.
Is that meant for me, eh?
Oh, I saw your old antics when I came in. Mind you, she's a very nice little girl.
She is. Would you put in a good word for me?
I won't. I knew you were all in love making.
I'm afraid I'm not much of a hand at that.
There's nothing to it. Just tell her that you like the colour of her hair and her eyes. I'll sing a song to her, even if we have the wife of a drag, which is what you have.
You seem to know all about it.
Oh, I did a little bit of it, my dear.
Please, I didn't know what Uncle Michael, we have it here.
Sure. I'll go on and help you to bring it up. I suppose in spite of a little job, you might as well stay for a cup too. I'll go down and give Lizzie a hand to bring up the tea.
Oh, by all means, I wouldn't be a spite for a friend.
What do you mean, spite for? If you think I'm going down there to be with that one, you're mistaken. I'm going down to give that idiot there a chance to do some of the foolish things I did. A spite sort. I suppose for the rest of my life, everywhere I'd go, I'd be falling over her. Without any joke, whatever.
And now before you go, important omission. We're very thankful to the brothers for putting the place at our disposal and for their preparatory work in preparing it. Thanks very much, brothers. And I hope we'll be back again with another performance. Slán is pronounced.
Thank you.